Alex, ladies and gentlemen, we welcome you to our next lecture within our lecture series on philanthropy, giving and collecting, a timeless cultural and social practice. Today, Alex Turini from Università Bocconi in Milan will talk to us about cultural philanthropy. But before we introduce him, let me give you some further information. As you could read on our website, this event will be recorded. It will be made available online later, like the lectures before. With regard to data protection, we conclude that you agree with the recording if you participate in this event. The recordings of our last sessions can be found following the link on our homepage. Like in the last session, we made arrangements to allow for more interaction in the discussion after the presentation. Of course, questions can be written in the chat, but you can also post them yourself. To do so, please write in the chat that you would like to speak out. We will put you on the list of speakers then, and when we ask you for your contribution, please switch on your camera and microphone before you start to speak. While the event this afternoon is in English, you can also ask your questions in German, and we will then try to translate and interpret question and answer to the speaker and to you again. And the last hint, to avoid noise and disturbance in the background and to facilitate the broadcasting, please switch your microphone and camera off when you're not speaking. So far for the introduction, and it's always like a stewardess on the plane. Volker, would you introduce our guest today?
It is my pleasure. Welcome this afternoon, Alex, our colleague, Professor Alex Turini from Bocconi University in Milano. He holds a chair in public management and has already been a collaborator and appreciated colleague in a number of research projects that we did together, because Alex has public management always viewed with a special focus on the arts and culture and with a special focus on philanthropy. So we have common interests between our research context and Alex's track record as a researcher. He has in particular been interested in policies and management of the cultural sector, which he always viewed in the light of looking at both the non-profit and the public sectors. And he has been at Bocconi for many years. I think it is 10 meters, approximately 10 years now, serving in different leadership functions, directing their master's program in management and administration, but also their master in international arts management. And so it is my particular pleasure to welcome you, Alex, to our series and to our discussions, and hopefully to continue the exchange in the context of our project on giving, philanthropy and collecting in the long durée. And I suggest the floor is now yours for introducing us, and I'm sure it will be a picturesque experience. Thank you for joining us, Alex.
Thank you, Volker. Thank you, Adrian. This is like a very great pleasure, because I have my nerves in Heidelberg for Lauren. So this is really a coming back. So let me just share my screen, and just I want to, as Volker told, that it would be like picturesque, I prepared like a presentation that is in a way presenting some pictures also. So today I want to speak a little bit with you about cultural philanthropy. This is like a research domain that I started investigating recently with a more let's say, attention, because as Volker was saying, I was more interested in the public policy part, and now I'm moving and shifting more into the third sector philanthropy domain. And I will start with this sentence that is "Io ho quello che ho donato," as extracted 100 years ago in 1921, Gabriele D'Annunzio bought the villa in Gardone Riviera on the Garda Lake. This villa belonged to Andy Tode, a German art historian at the time of the Weimar Republic, and his wife Daniela von Bulow, that was the nephew of Franz Liszt, the famous pianist. The villa is known now as Vittoriale degli Italiani, and would have housed the poet's wide collection of thousands and thousands of books, ceramics, objects, manuscripts, and artworks. Now it's a public-private foundation, open to the public and devoted to the study of D'Annunzio's life. The aphorism, "Io ho quello che ho donato," I have what I gave, is engraved at the entrance of the house, and it welcomes the thousands of visitors attending the museum. Provocatively, as D'Annunzio always wanted to be, it means that those who are generous end up possessing what they have given in another guise. The quotation resonates well with the theme I want to explore, cultural philanthropy. In my opinion, this field presents some interesting insights about how philanthropy developed in the longer duration. I will adopt the definition of cultural philanthropy that is connected to individuals' love for arts and culture, and it includes both collecting and giving of cash and artworks, as well as developing activities, cultural activities or activities of philanthropic foundation and similar institution operating in the arts. I will discuss about the main forms of cultural philanthropy as they have developed and institutionalized in Europe and in the US, and I will briefly argue about which type of philanthropy, not only in the arts, should be supported by government in the next future and why. Cultural philanthropy is not only important to understand the multiple paths philanthropic behavior took in the past, but also because cultural organizations shape our way of thinking and behaving as citizens. They embody and shape the values of a community, and because they belong to the heritage, the history of the community, sometimes they influence the community more than other anchor organizations like schools, hospitals, or universities. In order to explore different models of cultural philanthropism, I would refer to spot cases taken from an epoch that experienced a resumption of cultural life and the flourishing of a new model of social order centered on the city, that developed as a reaction to feudalism, and it was conceived as a community of free men. And of course, the city was also the object of a very known Max Weber manuscript. In these centuries, when humanism and Renaissance blossom in Italy, religious and secular mecenatism and philanthropy became a common practice, and they assumed different forms, lively represented and legitimated. Basically, this is like an epoch in which cultural philanthropy in different forms, a variety of cultural philanthropy form emerged. And central northern Italy was really the cradle of all of these. Consider that in the 14th century, there were already 96 cities with more than 5,000 inhabitants, 53 of which with more than 10,000 inhabitants. And if we took, for example, Netherlands, managed to quickly imitate the Italian model, but for example, the average European incidence of population living of the city was only 10%, basically half of what was the Italian situation. So, looking at cultural philanthropy, the first story that I want to present is the story of a businessman whose name is Oliviero Forzetta, who lived in Treviso, near Venice, between 1300 and 1373. Son of the notary Niccolò, who had accumulated a considerable amount of money through usury loans, Oliviero achieved the title of notary when he was 20, but following the father's example, he preferred the profession of money lender to the profession of notary. Oliviero was a man without letters, but he had an intense passion for courts and objects of art and antiquity. He was able to form a library and an artistic archaeological collection that could have compared with a lately Renaissance collection. Among other antiquities, the attention of Forzetta fell on two important marble high reliefs that I showed here that came from the throne of Saturn of the Ravenna Basilica of San Vitale and dating back to the first century after Christ. Now they are preserved in the Archaeological Museum of Venice, and these putti would have been later source of inspiration, as we can see, of Mantegna, Lombardo, and Sansovino. Forzetta never managed to secure a direct lineage, despite his five wives. When still in good health, he dictated in 1368 his will. Having no children, he left his estate to the confraternity of Santa Maria de Battuti, he was a brother of, arranged that after his death, the art object should have been sold and that the revenues from them, from the sale, should have been given to poor girls. In this way, his patrimony suffered a very fast dispersion. And despite the recommendation of Forzetta, who wanted his code secured to the benches by chains, also the book collection was soon lost. Why Oliviero Forzetta is important? Because he noted all the purchases he made in Venice, thus leaving us with the oldest known evidence of a collection of art and archaeology. The document lists various arts objects, and we might figure out that Forzetta collectionism helped the blossoming of humanistic culture in Venice some decades later. Forzetta represents the first type of cultural philanthropist, namely a private collector. One might argue that the act of collecting cannot be envisioned as a form of giving. And actually, cultural economists would include collecting well as a paradigmatic form of consumption, as the open-endedness of the collection resonate well with the continuous search of novelty in contemporary consumer behavior. Far from being donors or givers, collectors are also fiercely competing in the arts market in order to buy the best piece of arts in the market. And nowadays we see how the international arts market are populated by collectors that are competing among each other. So are collectors philanthropists? Well, my view is that art collectors, as a fully rational and self-interested economic agents, are, like, let's say, like portraying these agents as fully rational and self-interested economic agents is not useful and also unrealistic. In my research about the Texas arts collector, I figured out that the advent of globalization, digital technologies, together with arts market disintermediation, that is the professionalization of art dealers and advisors, so gatekeepers also, impoverished the genuine civic sentiment and pro-social purpose of art collectors. Yes, art collectors might be philanthropy, philanthropist or generous actors, benevolent actors, pro-social actors, when arts markets are geographically limited, the people know each other, this intermediation is not fully developed in arts market. Arts collectors network resembles the one you might find in Florence or Venice in the 14th century. So collectors market exchange typically, if when they are local, are embedded in social networks with punish speculative behaviors and rely on trust and friendship. Texas arts collectors, for example, competitively bid in auctions to purchase the best piece of Texas arts, but at the same time, they join in association, like TACO, that is like a very funny name for Texas, that is the Texas Art Collectors Organization. And they organize seminars, they exchange information and news about Texas arts. They meet monthly at different collectors' homes for both buying each other collection, new purchase, but also to have a beer together. The collection seldom begin purposely. They begin without a rational purpose. Sometimes it's the fascination for a single item or the need to furnish a new home. Artworks are gathered together for multiple purposes. Aesthetic pleasure, which is emotional. Economic investment, for sure, which is rational. But also social advancement, which is political, education and refinement, which is intellectual, or to broaden one's social life. Instead of bowling alone or watching football games at home or in stadiums, some people collect work of art and explore with other people arts domains. What is interesting about this ethnographic research is that collector social relationship and trust count. For example, when a Texas art piece is sold in auction, instantaneously the collector's network work together, unite to fight any bidder from outside the network itself. They don't want that outsider basically steal the work of art. They care that this type of heritage remain in Texas, even if in private hands, and they support and organize the self-funded traveling exhibition of Texan arts, both to increase the value of this type of art, but also to reinforce Texan cultural identity. Above all, an explicit philanthropic aim emerges when collectors think about the future of their collections. And we would need more studies and research to understand and explore the when, how, and why arts collectors become also philanthropists. So also in collecting, when we speak about collecting, we might look at collectors as philanthropists, and I would figure out that collectors are closer, I mean, the portrait of a collector is more closer to Walter Benjamin portrait of collectors as those individuals that through their purchases save arts from commodification and the dissipation that markets exert. In order to understand the second and third type of cultural philanthropy, let's go back to the Italian 14th century and let's look at other type of cultural philanthropism, mecenatism, and what I called capitalist philanthropy. And I want to present two main example of these two type of philanthropies that are Can Grande della Scala from Verona and Enrico Scomegni from Padua. Can Grande lived in Verona between 1291 and 1329, and Verona with the Scaligeri family had become a city of great political importance. With Can Grande, the city became a cultural center, anticipating the splendor the Renaissance patronage and mecenatism developed shortly thereafter in Florence with Cosimo de' Medici. I want to focus on the patronage relationship that Can Grande built with Dante Alighieri, Italy's equivalent of Shakespeare. Being exiled from Florence and in need of a patron, Dante first visited Verona in 1303, staying until the following year as a guest of Bartolomeo della Scala, the brothers of Can Grande. He returned to stay with Can Grande, and basically Can Grande della Scala appears in the 17th canto of the Divine Comedy, Divina Commedia, in this verse. So recognize shall his magnificence, Can Grande magnificence, become after that his enemies will not have the power to keep mute tongues about it. So Dante and Can Grande relationship is a good example of patronage, in which something very important matters, that is reciprocity, that is different from giving or exchange. The famous and widely debated epistle letters that Dante wrote to Can Grande, dedicating him the entirety of his Paradiso, epic poem, is an enactment of the oath of friendship, a return on a promise, and a gesture of sincere gratitude for an unreciprocal gift that Can Grande ensured the poet. In this sense, as Paul MacLean recently wrote, patronage did not simply signify the top-down distribution of material rewards, nor a lavish support of philosophy and the arts. It was pervasive, bottom-up, political-cultural phenomenon, an institution in the sociological sense as a set of relatively routine or standardized activity sequences, or as an unorganized established procedures that support and reproduce a set of shared expectations about the world and how it operates. Also, the life of Enrico Scrovegni, the founder of Cappella Scrovegni in Padova, was in some way impacted by Dante. Enrico Scrovegni, you can see him portrayed in the Cappella Scrovegni here on the left. Enrico Scrovegni was from a family of money lenders too. And Dante put Scrovegni Sr., the father of Enrico Scrovegni, in a special place in the hell this time, reserved just for him to repent from his sins as a moneylender and exploiter of the less fortunate. Either to give back what his father took away with his profession, or as a strategic move to launch his political career in Padua, Enrico Scrovegni decided to devote part of his accumulated wealth to the construction of a chapel, which is now known as Cappella Scrovegni. He hired Giotto, the most celebrated fresco painter of the day, to decorate the inside of the chapel with scenes from the life of Christ. And in the frescoes, as you might see, Enrico Scrovegni was not humble, but is depicted as kneeling in an act of devotion, and is presenting a model of the chapter itself. Scrovegni is not only depicted in Paradise, as we can see, but is also of the same size of other saints and angels in order to profile himself as one of the just, as a figure could play a role in the city's future fortunes. So Scrovegni, compared to Can Grande, represent a third different type of giving behavior, different from mecenatism. The Scrovegni story is actually a typical American story, and it might be considered as a precursor of welfare capitalism or capitalist philanthropy, like the Carnegies or Rockefellers or Bill Gates. Enrico Scrovegni wanted to give back something that his family deprived from the community. A primitive application, according to me, of the restitution principle that is so common in the US. Just as American welfare capitalism is based on the agreement under which companies had the task of taking on the well-being of their employees and their families. A capitalist thus returns part of the profit it has earned to those who have contributed to obtaining them. For Scrovegni, it was not giving back directly to the community, but for Scrovegni, this type of giving back would have resulted in the destination of the patron's wealth to the building of a ceto. In modern time, it would be like the constitution of a foundation as a result of this act of giving back. What I want to remark here is the different kind of motivation that might ground cultural philanthropy and philanthropy in general. An obligation to give back, or an attempt to increase individual reputation, and remember that individual reputation is an individual asset, is nothing connected with the relationship between the giver and the recipient. This was like what Enrico conceived. A patron and a cultural entrepreneur on the other side that relates to an artist establish long-term collaborative and reciprocal relationship in the case of Can Grande. So there is, however, after these three form of philanthropies, that there is like another, a last one, as last form of cultural philanthropy that we might trace back in history, and that is resurging also nowadays, by the way. I would label this cultural crowdfunding. Apart from speaking about digital crowdfunding platforms like Kickstarters, I will be stuck to the 14th century, but we have to move a little bit westward from Veneto to Milano, and we have to explore the construction of the most iconic building of the city, the Duomo Cathedral. As recent studies by Martina Saltamacchia have shown, like many other cathedrals in Europe, the Duomo Cathedral in Milano was not built thanks to the munificence of the Viscontis, the prince, but by the work and contributions of Milanese people, of the city's Christian community. The organization in charge of the building of the cathedral was the Fabrica, Veneranda Fabrica del Duomo di Milano, which collected the philanthropic efforts of all citizens in Milano. And it is really interesting to read the Saltamacchia articles describing the fundraising activities, the philanthropic behavior of the members of this Fabrica. So in this article, quote, citizens of any crafts, tailors, millers, butchers, carpenters, fishermen, doctors, pharmacists, went to the cathedral on their day off to offer their hands generously and with no monetary remuneration. Work was not the only way one could take part in building the cathedral, so they were not only volunteers, but of course they were also donors. Sometimes it happened that workers, sculptors and architects employed by the Fabrica donated their salary for the same cause. And the Fabrica implemented an effective network of fundraising, employing multiple instruments that any nonprofit organization should imitate in a way. Well, of course, the main place of the collection for the collection of the donation was the altar in the Church of Santa Maria Maggiore, the old basilica. But not everyone had the time to bring their donation to the altar. So in order to reach all the people, boxes were located at the major crossroads of the city and the countryside, as well in places where people might gather. Churches and chapels, to be sure, but also at the gates of the city, in front of the room used by the Archbishop Vicar for audiences. From its inception, the Fabrica obtained the right to seek donation also in the territories of the dukedom. Teams formed by two priests, two lay officials of the Fabrica, and two boni homines, citizens of Milano, would go to the countryside villages around the city to celebrate morning mass, announcing on that occasion the news of the cathedral construction. At the conclusion of the mass, they were awaiting generous donors, and a group of six people passed door to door throughout the village. It will be long to describe everything, but I want only to highlight the puelle cantagole, the girls with the singing throats that helped the Fabrica in its devout fundraising. This young lady, dressed in white, paraded through the street of the city and the villages nearby, singing and dancing in the square and at the crossroad to encourage popular donation. So this was like a collective giving efforts, really a crowdfunding project that was also mirrored by a quite democratic governance structure of the Fabrica. And I want to highlight the democratic governance structure of this organization. Not only all the donations were recorded, specifying the destination of each gift, but the main decisions were collectively taken through the Fabrica elected council, which met weekly to deliberate on all matters regarding the construction, management, and administration of the cathedral. The three main stakeholders at the time, the prince, the church, and the people, were all represented in the council. It was like a membership organization with representatives from the public, from the church, and from the citizens. In particular, citizens were represented by 50 residents per district. They convened weekly, not to solve emergency situations only, but also to monitor the ongoing long-term project and the fundraising campaign. This flat governance structure was quite common at the time, and the same type of organization characterized the Fabrica in different cities in Italy and elsewhere, and at that time also corporative guilds, which were engaged in cultural philanthropies as well, or confraternities existed. I mean, we have to remember that the murals, for example, the murals of the Shark Cathedral have been funded, have been built thanks to the philanthropies of prostitutes in that city. So philanthropism was not only something connected to the prince or wealthy donors, but also to all, let's say, but connected, and it include all the citizen social strata. Nowadays, we can find similar forms of organizing in social cooperatives, social enterprises, association, or loose forms of participative network. So our journey in Northern Italy ends here, but it enables us to come up with at least four forms of cultural philanthropy, which, let's say, survived with alternative fortunes. Collectionism, mecenatism, capitalist philanthropism or foundations, and what we have labeled as crowdfunding or cultural crowdfunding. So This example tells us about different type of motivation in collecting and giving behavior, but also different governance structures. Markets, networks, we have spoken about hierarchies like foundation or association with different degrees of democratic decision-making process, regulating the economic and social behavior of private agents in the arts and cultural field. Also nowadays, all these initiatives complement, above all in Europe, the role of government in preserving and promoting the heritage and in producing new cultural artifacts and activities. So the next question, so from a public policy perspective, is now, should the government support this form of cultural philanthropy that are private? And if so, which type of cultural philanthropy deserve more support? And I will devote the second part of my lecture to this question. Actually, to answer these questions, and above all the first question, is to solve a basic dilemma shaping the field of cultural policy and cultural economics from its inception. The dilemma relates to the legitimacy and extent of government intervention in the arts and the role of private initiatives in the field. To date, as we know, cultural philanthropy and private philanthropy in general, not only cultural philanthropy, is heavily criticized in the US. I rely on Robert Rice's book, Just Giving, for the main criticism. He criticized the inequality that private philanthropy is perpetuating in the US. His argument has not been connected to the usual criticism that the money that are poured in US charities and foundations come from capitalists, mega profits, sometimes from unethical businesses like in the case of the Sackler family and the Purdue Pharma. And he is not relying on the fact that these profits should be distributed to employees instead of laundering money in charities. Rob Guy proved that activities that are funded by ordinary giving and foundation, in the end, benefit the richer rather than the poor or the disadvantaged. And also Darren Walker, the president of the Ford Foundation, one of the most important foundations operating in the cultural sector, speaks about a strategic philanthropy, highlighting the need of a new gospel of wealth, which cares more about social justice and equality. As a matter of fact, all these claims, so the fact that private philanthropy is basically unjust, that it creates discrimination, is something real also for what regards the cultural sector. As this chart shows, if you look at the US, only 54% of adults attend any artistic, creative, or cultural activities in a year, and those that attend the arts are the wealthier and the most educated, and also the oldest. So cultural access, the effects of a system that relies on private philanthropies is this, is just privilege the wealthier and the most educated that can attend the arts. However, if we think about the public support, we have to highlight that, for example, in 2019, American taxpayers paid only 3.14 euros, only 3 euros, as for the for supporting directly arts institution and the access to the arts. Of course, Rob Reich and also my PhD supervisor, Michael O'Hare, would add the amount of taxes that would add to this amount of direct support from tax payers, also the amount of taxes that donors save because of tax deduction, which are not collected by the Internal Revenue Service and which are not at the disposal of the general population. On top of that, Rob Reich offers a criticism to foundation in terms of lack of accountability and unreasonable subsidize perpetuity of the founder's desire. As Rob Reich says, the dead hand of the donor reaches out from the grave and strangles the preferences of all future generation of smaller donors and taxpayers. So, all these data and all these criticisms are basically supportive of something that we know very well in Europe, that is a direct government intervention and a welfare system that grant access to arts and culture. I mean, we might expect that in Europe the situation is completely different and that thanks to the welfare and thanks to the government direct support, the access to culture is granted. This is, however, not true, and the same discrimination exists also in Europe, and these slides in a way shows this. As a matter of fact, only 64% of adult population in Europe before the pandemic attended the arts or other cultural activity. And if we look at some countries like Greece and Italy, both of them reported 47% as a share of the population that attended the arts at least once before the pandemic. And if we go, more into details, we see that, for example, in Italy, museum and exhibition are not visited by 68% of the population. Classical music concerts are deserted by the 89%. 79% never went to the theater. Of course, I mean, these figures are different if we look at the Nordic country and even Germany, but I mean, basically, as an average, the access to culture is granted to 10% more of the population in comparison to the American system. However, if we look at the support that each taxpayers are granting with their taxes to arts and culture, we discover that each resident in Europe as an average give 131 euro in taxes to sustain cultural institutions like museums, theater, and libraries that are often run by governmental or quasi-governmental type of agency. So basically, we are in a situation in Europe that taxpayers are paying 40 times more than Americans, getting only something like 10% more or of wider access to the arts. So arguments supporting the idea that state intervention grants equal access more than other systems that are based more on philanthropy fall short. And my claim is that on the contrary, the comparison with the US situation grounds a good rationale in favor of expanding private philanthropy in Europe. First of all, data shown before disclose that a system that is based more on cultural philanthropy and tax expenditures will be able to avoid at least that a blue collar or a nurse are obliged, like in Europe, to support the night at the opera of an old rich lawyer or a successful businessman and his partner. But at least that amount of money should be spent for education and schools rather than supporting elite organization, elitarian organization like museums and theaters. Second of all, a wider delegation and decentralization to individuals will increase diversity in the production of cultural activities, and it will allow an expression of different cultures and different value. Basically, if we import a system of tax expenditures, it would allow the state to provide support for a society's cultural structure while outsourcing judgments about the relative quality or value of different pursuits, or minimizing concerns about violating viewpoint neutrality from the state. As NYU political philosopher Ryan Pevnik recently put it, there is an important place for philanthropic efforts within the ideal of democratic equality, one that ought not be displaced by collective decision-making or ordinary market provision, either by the state or by the market. In particular, advocates of democratic equality should support a substantial role for the philanthropic support of cultural projects. This is like important. He says the argument for this claim is that although there is reason to invest in building and maintaining a rich cultural framework, direct government attempts to do so insofar as they must select particular cultural projects. This risk disrespecting citizens committed to other traditional ways of life. So a system in which direct government support is embarrassing because for the public agencies, because it influences what should be preserved as a free domain, and it in a way impact on what is the free expression of values, of cultural values and ideas that the cultural sector should be characterized of. So we claim that cultural philanthropy, because of this argument and not only because of some economic argument, might be developed and implemented. So there is one last point that I want to share with you that is connected not only to the answer to this question, should government support cultural philanthropy? And my answer is yes, because of the reason that I showed you before, but it is more connected to another question, that is, which type of cultural philanthropy or which type of philanthropic organization government should support. And here I want to explore a little bit with you something that I call civic governance structure. So there is basically there are many choices. If cultural philanthropy might grant more, let's say, cultural democracy, the way in which, as Tony Bertelli says, the way in which democracy is administered, that means the type of governance structure that are more suitable to avoid a limitation of democracy matters. And as a matter of fact, our review of cultural philanthropy suggests the forms of civic governance structure of what we have labeled as cultural crowdfunding as appropriate form of governance to preserve and grant democracy. These civic governance structure are example of independent agencies in which, of course, political representatives restrain themselves from interfering on decision-making process, but at the same time, citizens' democratic involved is incentivized. And the power of philanthropists, the turbo philanthropists, the capitalist philanthropists might be restrained. Nowadays, as we have seen, they have the legal status of cooperatives, membership, organizations, associations, social enterprise. And what is interesting, if we look at the history, is that they have flourished during the 13th and 14th century, but their development has been slowed down in general and in the field of cultural philanthropy. With the ascent of welfare systems, citizens have been obliged to pay taxes in order to mitigate the negative drawbacks of market system. Where free markets have been left to work, welfare capitalism, foundations, charities have been established, as we have seen in the US. Communitarian third sector organizations have been not much supported by the state and not much developed. These are forms of organizations and governance structure where individuals are free to give time or money, as we have seen in the example of the Veneranda Fabrica, and they accept to be part of some social norms of behavior within the governance structure, within the organization, as they participate, as they adhere to participate in this organization. Basically, this type of membership organization rely on reciprocal relationship. And I want to introduce and end my lecture with a hint of the importance in the third sector practice, but also in the third sector research, the importance about reciprocal relationship and reciprocity as a category of study. As Italian economists Stefano Zamani and Luigino Bruni argue, reciprocal relationship can be viewed as a series of independent, although interconnected, bidirectional transfers. However, they are basically voluntary, which means that no transfer is a prerequisite for the occurrence of another transfer back. So there is no external obligation and there is no exchange of equivalents. If you are on the market, in a market system, of course there is an obligation among the parties. You pay something to have something when you buy something, right? You pay a price when you buy something, and this creates a sort of obligation. Reciprocal relationship does not include this type of obligation. In this sense, there is more freedom in reciprocity than in the exchange of equivalents. And this is like a crucial point. The reciprocal relationship is different because agents are not motivated for action by the expectation of a price signal. On the other hand, reciprocity must be distinguished also from pure altruism, which are one-way transfer. In basically, reciprocity is placed in an intermediate position between the exchange of equivalents and pure altruism. It's not like market exchanges, as I explained before, but it's not only pure altruism or philanthropy that in a way is without something, without expecting at all something back. So what is at stake in reciprocal relationship is not simply having or collecting or receiving and giving, but also being in the relationship with the other. So, I mean, what are the governance structure, and I will finish now, what are the governance structure that are rooted in reciprocity? Well, what we have seen before, they are all these membership organization with democratic governance structure. They are social cooperatives, social enterprise that are surging in Italy. And I want to finish, underline the importance of this type of organization. Here you have the example that I don't have the time to explain, of a Pio Monte della Misericordia, that is like a 17th non-profit organization that commissioned a Caravaggio painting and that adopted this type of civic governance structure, democratic type of governance structure. What I want to highlight is that the importance of this organization is not only connected to the fact that they grant democratic decision making and cultural participation, cultural democracy, but they also are the place where people might, let's say, learn how to behave in a civic society. They are basically locus, they are loci, they are a place where civicness is enacted, more than foundations and more in public funded or public run agency. People participate in this type of organization because they reciprocate something. They reciprocate their time or their money or their participation with the good, the public good, in this case, the possibility of enjoying cultural activity. So as a conclusion, we explore different ways cultural philanthropy developed, and we discovered the many different governance factors that might support collecting and giving behaviors, not only in the arts and cultural field. My hope is that above all, after the pandemic, an increased public awareness that individual responsibility matters as much as freedom and respect of the law might inspire the generation of new welfare action, which recoup the civic virtues of the Renaissance and reinvent governance structure that foster reciprocity, participation, and democracy among their members. And this shift of the tension towards the increase of civicness and social capital in a city or a rural area is important above all for cultural institutions like museums and theater that, as I addressed before, shape our way of thinking and our life and public happiness. Cultural institutions do not save life, but they make life better, life of citizens better, and this type of civic governance structure might be a greater training for civicness in the community in general. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alex, for this really opulent presentation, great pictures, and I've seen a lot of Italian cultural heritage in it. Thank you very much, and I'll give the floor to the audience first and see if we have any questions. Please just write in the chat if you would like to take the word and, well, looking forward to the discussion. Yes, Nicolas Jaspert would like to speak, so please turn on your microphone and your camera, and we're looking forward to your participation.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, wonderful. Well, first of all, thank you very much. This was highly interesting. I'm a medievalist in training, and I'm very interested in late medieval societies as you have described them. I have two questions. The first refers to what you described for the Middle Ages. The image I received is one of horizontal exchange processes, and I was wondering if there's a vertical dimension to this, in the sense that the one of the entities, perhaps the main entity which receives, isn't necessarily or needn't be necessarily the church as such, but perhaps the patron saint. What I mean is, do the donations go to the church or to the saint imagined as a receiving personal entity? My impression is that in pre-modern times, this thought is not unimportant, so that there's a transcendental and vertical dimension to the dynamics which you've described. And the second refers to the modern period. I think what you describe is absolutely convincing, and especially the comparison between the US and Europe. The question would be, how do you bring this change about which you were talking about? Because, to say it in a different way, how do you eradicate the state without killing cultural institutions first? Because in the USA, the founding fathers, since the founding fathers, the notion of the state as a philanthropological entity is not non-existent. So it brings social reputation, social capital to do what you've described. Whereas in Europe, as you said quite rightly, we have given this over to the state. If we take it away from the state, my fear is it will take a long time for for individuals in Europe to accept this as their job, to fall back, so to speak, in a pre-modern state of mind in which one accepts that the individual is in charge of doing this, or civic governance structures which we have nearly abolished, except if we look at the world of clubs and unions, etc., which I think is where these traditions are still alive in what the Germans call Vereinswesen. So I'm not sure if this is really much of a question, it's more of a problem which I'm just posing.
Thank you very much. Well, thank you, and also for your patience. I'm not an historian, so I just looked at this epoch just to figure out some example of how cultural philanthropy might, in a way, be. So, as to the first question about vertical donation. Let me tell you about the experience of the opera and the fabric in the cathedral. This was not totally in the hands of the church. So recent studies about that, all these fabric, are telling that both the prince and the church were, of course, indirectly represented within the fabrica. And so also in the case of the Milano Cathedral, of course, the Viscontis, let's say, put a lot of wealth for start this great project. But what is interesting about this governance structure is that the people were represented a lot, and also that first, because they were, let's say, representative of the different citizens. And in second thing is that they opposed all the attempts of the church and the prince to overcome the decision of the people. There are a lot of, let's say, instances and example on that. And also in terms of the personification, do they give to the church or do they give to the saint? There are like in this type of organization that it would be like really interesting to understand and to explore more. I mean, their, let's say, loyalty, their trust in the, let's say, documents, let's say that historians or we have, their trust and their intentions were more towards the community. Why did they give? They didn't give because of the for this instance, because of they wanted to let's say gain a place in heaven, but because they were, let's say, obliged to reciprocate among each other because of everyone was giving something for this type of this type of project and this type of adventure. So there is, let's say, of course there should be like more studies about that, but I mean, this is like, it seems that this is like the time where civicness and reciprocal relationship is much more developed. And this is like, also, well, again, I'm not an historian, but I mean, this is also like a very defined period in time in Italy that is before the, let's say, 15th century and the big duke and prince that in a way were more involved and wanted more. I mean, they were a political presence that was more important than when the cities flourished. And this is paralleled also to the, of course, development of the market system within the city. But there is like a lot of let's say, link that I would like to make also in terms of I mean what Max Weber says about this type of the city and I mean the type of let's say political culture at that time, but more than, let's say, I mean it's a matter of degree more than like a vertical, as you say, vertical relationship, like something that resemble authority, or I give because of the authority. There are hints that gives us the idea that these were more horizontal exchange, both in the cultural sector, let's say, both in this type of opera, I mean opera works, public works, and also in what happened in the economy that wanted to overcome feudalism. And as to the second question, yes, I mean, of course, I don't want just to erase the state from the landscape here. It would be like quite impossible, of course. But what is my argument is this, that in terms of public policy, above all in the arts and cultural sector, what I call the cultural philanthropy, that is like a private giving, has definitely not been supported in Europe. So we will never end as in the US, for sure, but we should a little bit hybridize, I mean, meaning we should mix some of the policy tools that in the EU has are developed, like tax expenditure, for what to give, let's say, more chance to the private entrepreneurship, to the private initiative, but not because it is like ideological, but because the state has shown not to be to grant open access, and maybe giving nowadays, above all nowadays, giving more incentive to the private initiative might push towards more participation and more inclusion. And well, I made like the parallel with like the crowdfunding, let's say, type of structure in the 14th century, and what might be today all the crowdfunding, let's say, platform that technologies in a way allow. So that might be type of tools that incentivize participation and might be supported by the state. The point is that public support so far has been quite, let's say, unfair, and that the tax paid by people, by all the general people, are supportive of the enjoyment of a small social strata, that are the richer and the more educated.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Volker, you want to continue with a follow-up question?
Yeah, first of all, Alex, thank you very much for this rich presentation and also for the wealth of analytical and systematic arguments that you offered us to consider. And I do actually find it quite tempting to explore your idea of reciprocity a little further, but let me provoke you a little bit in the interest of maybe soliciting some further thinking. I have an impression that your examples, especially your Italian examples of the 13th, 14th centuries, would allow us to have two readings. One sort of modern optimistic reading would be that the reciprocity can be viewed as an intermediary structure, as an intermediary institution in a sociological sense, building the civicness of the citizens. But a second reading, for instance, when I especially think of Can Grande della Scala or his other colleague building the chapel, we could also read it as reciprocity in exchange for power and reciprocity in exchange for paradise, for religious salvation. And I'm wondering if these two principles are not constantly competing. So we can't really come down on one or the other side, but it is a sustained tension. And even in modern times, the role of philanthropy, if understood as an intermediary institution, is not always about civicness, but it is also about power, and it is also about sort of paying tribute to that power. What would you say about that?
Yeah, this is like what I wanted to explain to explain, or just to make clear about this different form of cultural philanthropy. So, I mean, the main difference that I see here, going in the direction of your reflection, is from, let's say, the Scrovegni example, and first, and the Can Grande example. This is something that might parallel the difference between, let's say, founders and capitalists, or corporate foundations, and mecenates, and social entrepreneurs, and let's say community builder. I'm not going into details about what might be like the motivation of Can Grande della Scala, but what I'm sure is that while the Sloveni or just the corporate foundation motivation for sure is to gain reputation as an individual asset or reputation as an individual or a corporate, let's say, asset, or in a way denying a type of relationship with the community. That is what also Rob Reich is saying, because it is like the will of a guy that made a foundation for perpetuity, for forever. In the mecenatism is something different, because what is important is not the act only of Can Grande or this type of mecenatism, but it's the relationship between the mecenate and the artists. So even in, let's say, in terms of, let's say, public policy, we should, or the government should incentivize this type of cultural entrepreneurship, or this type of cultural entrepreneurs that are nurturing the artists or the cultural productions in the territory, establishing a relationship with them, so that it's not only giving, but I give you something in order to have something back, or I'm expecting something back that is not, as Dante and Can Grande was saying, that is not something that might be priced, basically. So it's basically a mutual donation with no market value. So I think that this type of enterprise, this type of organization that roots in this principle of reciprocity, that is similar to the market exchange, but it is completely different from a foundation, and it is completely different from the state intervention, might be nurtured more. And this is why, not only because the hope is that thanks to the recognition of the other people, to the recognition and let's say space given to the contribution of the artist of or those that are participating to the cultural enterprise, you might enhance the civic capital. It's not only this, it's also that you might hope that cultural participation expand. So it's you know, a matter of you know, supporting a type of organization like membership organization, association, or a social enterprise that are there in the territory because they want to build basically relational goods. So they want to establish relationship with the community. And I mean, it's much different from also giving like tax exemption or benefiting founders that give a set of assets for the society on top of the fact that they decide what is the destination of these assets, and they oblige, having tax exemption, also all the taxpayers to follow their desire. Here, decision making and the relationship counts. On the other end, I see like either the state or the private philanthropists as basically benevolent, altruistic, but imposing a will over the community. That is the difference between, let's say, charity as we have experience also in Europe, and strategic philanthropy or, let's say, social entrepreneurship. I want to just stress another thing. I mean, in this type of reasoning, I mean, even the corporate social responsibility might be like another facet or another aspect of this type of, let's say, reciprocal relationship that you might establish. Of course, I mean, a lot of discussion is about that, but I mean, the seed, the principle is a little bit the same.
Thank you. At the moment, we have no further questions in the chat, so let me take the chance to pose a question myself. Coming back to your example from Texas, because I have to say I'm more familiar with the Italian examples than with the examples from Texas. You said this collectors from Texas are trying to create a kind of cultural identity, a Texas cultural identity, if I got you correctly. So the first question would be, is it different from the cultural identity in Texas before this collection started? Is there something like a cultural identity imposed by the collections, the right cultural identity? And if we leave this to collectors and to cultural philanthropes, is it then still the collection, the cultural identity of the people, or is it something imposed by others?
So thank you for this, because this is like a very interesting experience that I had thanks to my visiting in SMU Dallas. And I mean, of course, I mean, these type of collectors are trying to restore an identity of, let's say, Texas and Dallas that has been in a way lost. Basically, they are collecting Texas art, above all Texas art from the 20s, in order to go back to a time where Texas and above all the city of Dallas had its own culture. That was like, I mean, all these paintings were representing the run for oils and this type of, you know, dream, in a way, that Texas experienced. So in a way, there is, this is like a movement that might seem as a reaction of an identity that is lost, that is not dreamt any longer. The interesting thing about this example is that I mean, this like type of subculture. I mean, these collectors are like, let's say, group of people that are not you know, so popular, let's say, in the state. But what is, let's say, interesting, according to me, is that thanks to their private interaction, that is not only the market exchanges among them, or in auction, during auction, but it's also interaction in social networks. Little by little, this type of art influenced the decision of those cultural institutions that are there in order to, in a way, represent an identity, or in a way, mirror what is the culture of the community, that are museums. What I'm saying is that thanks to the let's say, exchange activities of these collectors, Texas art and all the symbols and the symbolic, the symbolism of Texas art has been recognized by museum, and museums that might be either public or funded by big philanthropists, but are legitimate institutions that in a way mirrors the identity or the culture of a community, are recognizing this art, and they are organizing exhibition, they are inviting, organizing seminars and lectures about that. So basically, it is like the interaction of these collectors, both in networks and in the market, with the purpose of recouping an identity that was lost, that caused the interest of what are the legitimate institutions that are museums and cultural institutions in general, even universities, that are like the institutions that are legitimate to, in a way, represent or to communicate or to spread the values and the culture of the community. So it's a really a bottom-up approach that I investigated and I experienced. On top of the fact, and so, I mean, in terms of the social structure, what we are, I mean, in terms, in 50 years, what we are experiencing is that, I mean, museums are creating, I mean, they want to make, now the next step will be to establish a museum of Texan art. And this is something that comes from these, if you want, grassroots activities of these collectors. The second thing that is interesting is in the portrait of collectors as, let's say, philanthropists or agents that are not only pushed by their economic interest and self-interest. Of course, they want their paintings, that, I mean, they want the value of the arts increase, but I mean, their action and their decision and their purchases are driven by something else that is not only the economic interest. That is something that you don't see in more established arts market, or think about contemporary arts, or think about other type of collectors that are not interested, that are not mecenates any longer, that are not interested in the value of the arts as vehicle of an identity or the culture of a community, but they are more interested in the value of they can get, that can grasp. And by the way, this type of agents are not the decision maker, but the decision maker are intermediaries like art galleries or advisors that feed the interest of these collectors. So that is the reason why the second thing that I that was like a wow moment is that when the market and the disintermediation works not so well, it's not global, it's more local, and it's in a way opaque and full of social ties, I mean embedded in a social tie, the speculation and this type of attitude do not exist, but a philanthropic attitude, philanthropic or let's say pro-social, pro-community attitude as a second and let's say outcome comes up.
Thank you for the explanation, it's very interesting. Okay, do we have any further questions? Coming more and more to the end, but there's still time, I'd say, for one further question at least. Okay. Volker, would you say something for the conclusion?
Well, thank you, Alex, for offering us interesting arguments for connecting the different categories of our title, of the title of our research context. Our research context, I remind all of us again, is about giving, philanthropy, and collecting. And it has already sparked a number of conversations among our own team, but you have offered us a whole range of different options of how to connect the two. And what I also find very interesting, and you just elaborated on it a moment ago, is the relationship to the market. In the case of the collecting of the arts, of the text and arts collectors, there are market mechanisms at play, but at the same time, there are community mechanisms at play. And that's different from what very often the philanthropic discussion seems to suggest. The philanthropic discussion has other relationships to the market. It has relationships through the endowment, through the origin of the wealth that is sort of put to a special purpose and for a typically longer period of time. While foundations are more like instruments that are restricting market activity, what you described about the collectors, the private art collectors, is activities embedded in both market and community ties and bringing the two together. So I think it has been a very stimulating contribution to our efforts of integrating the collecting into our, and when I say our, I'm speaking in the name of a number of our colleagues at Heidelberg who have already spent quite some work on philanthropy, on the giving and the non-profit sector, like you did, but we have less experience of working on collecting. And some of our sort of arts and humanities colleagues, of course, do, but you have offered us very convincing arguments to connect the two worlds, and I'm grateful for this offer that you have made, and I look forward to continue our exchange on this in the context of our own ideas becoming more elaborate and the potential future project framework becoming more specific, and then I'm sure it will be even more valuable to continue our discussion. Thank you very much for contributing today, Alex, and for those who have not been able to join us tonight, the presentation and this session will be available online in the recorded format on our website. So thank you, Alex, again, and I look forward to being in touch.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the invitation, and keep in touch. Gusti.
Ciao. Ciao.
Yeah. Thank you very much, and let's have a view into the future. We will continue our lecture series on the 16th of June after the Pentecost break. And then we will welcome Dr. Martin Tudel from Heidelberg University, and he will introduce us into the foundation sector in North America in the 21st century and talk also about the Clinton Foundation as one example of the sector. So I'd say stay tuned. Bye-bye.